So remember now, we spoke already about sorafenib, we spoke about regorafenib, we spoke about lenvatinib, we spoke about cabozantinib. We already are talking about four drugs, by the way, of which three already are FDA approved, being the sorafenib, of course, rego, of course, and lenvatinib is already FDA approved. And the cabozantinib, of course, is going through the FDA approval. We'll see where it's going to end up. But of course, positive data, positive outcome, published, as I said, in New England. But interestingly, on top of those four, there's a fifth one, and the TKI, that was really brought into more attention at the last ASCO, ramucirumab. So let's ask Peter. So ramucirumab, if I recall, there was a study that was negative of ramucirumab, and then out of nothing, we're talking about REACH2. Tell us the difference, and then why positive?
So ramucirumab is an antibody which interferes with the angiogenic pathway, and had been originally tested in the REACH trial. Was well tolerated, and there was a trend for an improved overall survival for those receiving ramucirumab, but the hazard ratio was not sufficient. In the subgroup analysis, it became apparent that those patients who had a high AFP, specifically above 400, were benefiting more. This was not a pre-specified endpoint, and therefore REACH was clearly a negative trial. And what was very interesting is that that information then was used by Lilly, and a second trial was set up. That's unusual. I mean, typically those negative trials end the story of a drug, but here it wasn't. And there was an enrichment for patients with AFP above 400, and it was a positive trial. There were a couple of differences, though, which are interesting, and probably the, let's say, integration asking for high AFP results in a different group of patients than if you take it at random, because probably investigators pushed their patients slowly over the limit of 400. And therefore, there were some unexpected outcomes. For example, in the placebo-treated group, this group was actually living longer, resulting in not as high an objective difference in overall survival between RAM-treated and placebo-treated patients as expected. But nevertheless, hazard ratio 0.7-something, so clearly a positive trial. And which is nice, it's the first trial now which we have where a biomarker can be used to stratify, and it is relatively well tolerated. It's not yet approved, but adding in second line to our armamentarium.
No, I totally agree. If anything, I'm coming to you, Riyad, because remember, to be fair also, before we carry on that discussion, that the ramucirumab data was simply presented as an abstract. We yet are to see the manuscript to understand more details. But Riyad, back to you. Other than we'd like to comment on AFP, is it really a marker for the disease? Your thoughts?
I mean, look, there's no doubt that we use it. I mean, there was historical precedent when it was used for diagnosis. That's sort of gone away. It's clearly something that I think most of us believe is a biomarker for more aggressive disease. We all fight it, but I think we all use it to follow patients. We can't use it in studies, and we can't quantify it, but yet we all use it. So it's one of these things. But I wanted to sort of add a little bit to what Peter was saying and sort of ask the panelists is, you know, the positive aspects of REACH2 aside of what Peter was listing, if you notice, most of the studies that are positive, your study, Ghassan, Jordi's, et cetera, the OS delta is in the 3-month range. Now you've got a positive study, but now it's in the month and a half range. And so I ask whether that is a factor for you now. Statistically, by trial design, it's positive, no problem. It's well tolerated, and it's a biomarker. Fantastic. But now you're in the 1.5-month range in terms of survival benefit. How do you digest that? Is that important to you? Is it just a positive trial, hence it should be used? Is the magnitude of the delta worth it? I ask because I don't know, and I ask because I'm curious about how you interpret that in terms of what is the lowest end of the survival difference that matters to you.
Absolutely. You know, these are important points, and there's many perspectives to take them. But let's ask Amit first. Again, you know, we are dissecting an abstract report, but your thoughts on that REACH2 study?
Yeah, so my thoughts are this. In terms of, you know, we had talked about AFP being a prognostic biomarker, which we have several studies showing that to be true. And we know that in terms of the mechanism of action, you know, AFP tends to be higher with VEGF activation. And so that may, in terms of in terms of the mechanism of action, in terms of this drug, it may actually provide some biological rationale in terms of supporting this. I will say my opinion on this trial, in terms of AFP being a biomarker, my issue is that when you take a look across all trials, those high AFP patients tend to do worse. And when you take a look at those, the subgroup of patients who have high AFP, all these other therapies tend to also have very similar hazard ratios. So while it's a biomarker, my concern is that it's not a specific biomarker that shows that RAM is going to work better than other therapies. So it doesn't necessarily help me in terms of treatment decision making. When I think of a biomarker, I think of a biomarker that will say this drug works better than, you know, drug Y. And I don't think we're there yet.
No, I totally agree. And if anything, very important point that one of the arguments that's been given for the REACH2 is that at the end of the day, maybe these patients, because of the high AFP level, they won't fare better anyway. And that's why the magnitude of the improvement is limited. But on the other hand, while this argument is there, I would say that we're hearing from everybody that we're still kind of, you know, I would say probably the best word is perplexed about like where to interpret or how to put there, where to put it per se. There's still kind of like a lot to learn from. And I would say, as I mentioned, like probably until the manuscript comes out, we'll probably hopefully learn a little bit more about that. And of course, we'll use it accordingly and we'll apply it accordingly to based on the interpretation at that time.